Welcome to today's webinar, Forgetting to Remember, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I am the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services here at Georgetown, and our presenter today is Dr. Bill Rebeck. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We had over 200 alums register for today's session, so we're thrilled that so many of you are able to join us. Before we begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 1 to 2 business days on our website. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are welcome to use one. It is important to note, if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. We're planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A component of today's webinar. A PDF copy of the PowerPoint slides shown during today's session will be emailed to you after. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today. Dr. Rebeck is a professor in Georgetown University's Department of Neuroscience and is an expert on genetic risk factors for Alzheimer's disease. He is from Cincinnati, Ohio, where he was taught by the Jesuits at St. Xavier High School. He received a bachelor's degree from Cornell University, majoring in chemistry, and a Ph.D. from Harvard University. He began studying Alzheimer's disease in 1991 in Germany on a Fulbright Fellowship, and then did research for over 10 years at Massachusetts General Hospital. He's been with us at Georgetown since 2003. We're so thrilled to have you here today with us, Bill, and I want to thank you in advance for your time and expertise, and I'm going to now turn it over to you.
Thank you, Emily, and thanks, everybody, for making the time to be part of this presentation today. I have to say I spend a fair bit of my time at Georgetown teaching undergraduates, teaching medical students, teaching graduate students, and I only hope that, you know, after they leave Georgetown, they will do like you guys are doing, and that is continuing to seek out opportunities to learn things. I'm going to talk a lot today about different aspects of Alzheimer's disease. I'll talk about a little bit about basic science, a little bit about genetics, a little bit about pathology of the disease, a little bit about clinical aspects of the disease and how we're presently treating it. So there's a lot of different topics that I'll be covering. Some of you will be more interested in some topics and less in others, but if you have any questions at all, it sounds like there's a way to get those questions to me, and I'll try to address those. So I probably don't have to introduce Alzheimer's disease too much to the people who are part of this program, but I do think it's worth remembering what a devastating disease it is. These are numbers that I'm showing about the number of cases in the United States of Alzheimer's disease. And on the x-axis, you can see different years. So in 2000, there was about 4 million people in the U.S. with Alzheimer's disease. And in last year, 2 years ago now, there was over 5 million people. And you can see as we go through every decade, that number is going to continue to rise. One of the things that I like to point out to people is that as a country, we seem to make a big deal about epidemics that might occur. And when we talk about Alzheimer's disease, I think we're in the midst of an epidemic that absolutely is occurring. The numbers that you see here are based entirely on the fact that as a whole, our population is aging. There will be more and more people at the ages where Alzheimer's disease is more common in the coming decades, and we will be dealing with this problem as it just gets worse and worse. The aging can be seen as we look at the percentage of people at different ages who have Alzheimer's disease. So, of course, it's not a disease that we see very much early in life, but by the time people are in their 60s and 70s, we see small percentages of people who have Alzheimer's disease. And then that percentage can increase dramatically so that in 70s and 80s, the number goes up to 15%. And as we look at people who are 85 and older, nearly half of people at those ages have Alzheimer's disease. So it's, of course, you know, a very devastating disease at those ages, not only for the people who have Alzheimer's disease, but for the people who are caring for them, because so often that is also an elderly spouse, for example. Of course, this human burden is also accompanied by an economic burden. The most recent estimates have been that it costs us as a country $183 billion in a year. And that's the cost that goes into Medicare and Medicaid for taking care of these patients, personal investments. And this is even an underestimate of how much we spend, because it doesn't include the cost that for individuals putting in their time to take care of these people in ways that are not being paid. So of course, in addition to the personal burden, there is this huge economic burden. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about the disease itself, and in order to talk about what Alzheimer's disease is, I think the first thing you have to talk about is what is normal aging of the brain. Alzheimer's disease is not normal aging, but let's just take a moment to talk about what is normal aging. As we get older, there are some things that we get better at, and there are some things we get a little bit worse at. And there are things like communication skills, comprehension. These are things that improve as we get older. Vocabulary improves as we get older. And then there are some things that, like your reaction time or finding the exact word to name something, that those things become a little bit harder. Your fluency becomes a little bit impaired. But those are minor changes. They don't have huge impacts on your lives. So we can all maintain what we refer to as our normal daily functions. And one of the terms that you'll hear me talk about later on is activities of daily living. So all the things you need to do to take care of yourself, getting dressed, eating. These are the things that are certainly maintained under conditions of normal aging. So, but Alzheimer's disease is clearly not that. It is not just a furthering of normal aging. It's a disease that progresses as people go through the disease. So it's a neurodegenerative disease, which means that the neurons in your brain are degenerating, and as you lose those neurons, you lose abilities. One of the terms that we'll talk about a lot as we go along is this term dementia. What we mean by that term dementia is that you have severe problems with memory, and that you also have problems in some other aspect of your brain function. So you might have problems finding the right words. You might have problems with judgment. But dementia means that you have a memory problem and some other problem. Alzheimer's disease is the most common form of dementia, and I'll come back to that point in a little bit. So people with Alzheimer's disease have this impairment in cognition, and that plays out as impairment in these activities of daily living. And so this is why, of course, Alzheimer patients need care to get through a normal day. After diagnosis with Alzheimer's disease, people do not die right away. The average lifespan can go 7 to 10 years, and can often stretch out to 20 years with Alzheimer's disease. The early signs of Alzheimer's disease are what you would imagine, that these are, there's a difficulty in learning, a difficulty retaining new information, and it's that new information that's particularly noticeable. So often people with Alzheimer's disease will ask a question, and not only will they not remember the answer that they are given, they won't remember that they asked the question. And so it can be quite jarring when it first happens if you are part of one of these conversations where somebody will say, you know, you'll be in a car with them, you'll be driving along, and they'll say, now where are we going? Oh, we're going to the store. You know, what are we going to get? Blah, blah, blah. You'll have a regular conversation, and then they'll come back to it, and they'll say, where are we going? And there'll be a moment when you think it maybe it's a joke, but then you'll realize, no, it's actually, they don't remember that you've just had that whole conversation. So that is the first early sign of dementia. As the disease progresses, there will be other things. People will forget memories that they've made in the past at later stages of the disease, but it's these new memories that are particularly susceptible early in the disease. So you might notice that people missing appointments, forgetting other aspects of recent conversations, and then as it goes along, some of this ability to reason and carry out more complex tasks are affected. One of the tests that we use in the clinic to examine whether somebody has Alzheimer's disease is, this is a relatively simple test. It's called the mini mental state exam, or the MMSE, and this will come up later in the talk as well, where there are fairly simple questions. You can look down this list and have a look at, see how the kinds of responses that people have trouble making if they have Alzheimer's disease. So we can run through this exam, and a normal person will score 28, 29, 30 points, but someone with Alzheimer's disease, you will start to see impairment, and as the disease goes along, the score on these mini mental state exams will get lower. There are you know, much more complex tests that are done here at Georgetown or at other clinics that specialize in Alzheimer's disease, but this is meant to be a relatively quick way to get a feeling of whether somebody has deficits that could indicate Alzheimer's disease. Now, when we talk about dementia and we talk about Alzheimer's disease, of course, there are other ways that somebody could have a memory problem or could have dementia. There are various conditions, one of which you might have heard about called vascular dementia. This just means the blood vessels in the brain there's some difficulty related to the blood vessels. So it could, for example, be a number of very small strokes that are causing problems in the brain. And if they're causing problems in the part of the brain involved in memory, then indeed there's going to be a memory problem. This slide has got a number of other things that can cause dementia. Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease is a prion disease. None of these are terribly common. There's often a dementia associated with Parkinson's disease. So people who have Parkinson's disease, who have these problems with their movement, sometimes that can progress to have problems with cognition as well. And a small percentage of all dementia is related to these other conditions. Alzheimer's disease is the most common cause of dementia, and it can also be seen very often with these other diseases. One of the things that I think is true is that as one thing goes wrong with the brain, this makes it the brain more susceptible to other bad things happening. So as I was saying with Parkinson's disease, one bad thing happening to your brain there, and then your risk of getting Alzheimer's disease is increased. Okay, so but what is Alzheimer's disease exactly? The way we define it is based on the pathology. So this is looking at somebody's brain after they've died of Alzheimer's disease. And when we do that, we see evidence of things that are not normally in the brain. And those are indicated here on a slide. And we give them two different names. We call them plaques and tangles. So if we look at somebody who's died of dementia, we look at their brains, and we see evidence of plaques and tangles, then we can definitively say this person had Alzheimer's disease. Sometimes you see people who have tangles but not plaques. That means that they had some other cause of dementia. They didn't have Alzheimer's disease. They had some other, they got demented for some other reason. But a lot of our work in terms of trying to prevent Alzheimer's disease or treat Alzheimer's disease is aimed at preventing whether these plaques accumulate or whether these tangles accumulate. And if we can prevent those things from accumulating, we think we'll be able to prevent Alzheimer's disease. The thing about these plaques and tangles is that they accumulate in specific parts of the brain. The two pictures of the brain shown on the top here are where the tangles accumulate, and the two pictures on the bottom are where the plaques accumulate. And then the scale bar down here just shows that the red areas mean that these are areas of the brain that are always affected, and yellow means that they're often affected, whereas like the blue areas mean that they're pretty much rarely affected. So this is a study that was done about 20 years ago now, where people looked at, scientists looked at the brains of 40 different individuals who died of Alzheimer's disease, and they said, okay, where in these 40 brains do we see the plaques, and where in these 40 brains do we see the tangles? And looking at the bottom here, looking at the plaques, basically when they looked at the frontal cortex, or they looked at the temporal cortex, or they looked at the visual cortex, they see plaques kind of everywhere. There's one little area deep in the brain where they tended not to see plaques. But in general, in all these different brains, they saw plaques kind of everywhere. When they looked for tangles, they saw a very different pattern. That is, there were some regions of the brain that were very strongly affected. So this area of the brain is called the hippocampus. This is the part of the brain that's responsible for new memories. So this is the part of the brain that you need to be functioning well in order to learn something new. That was always affected with tangles. There are other parts of the temporal lobe that are often affected with tangles. The temporal lobe is important for orientation, so knowing where things are in space. Naming things is an important function of the temporal lobe. The temporal lobe was very often affected in Alzheimer's disease cases. There were some parts of the brain that seemed to be almost never affected in Alzheimer's disease. And so this part of the cortex, for example, is the motor cortex. So this is responsible for initiating movements of your arms or your legs. There's the primary visual cortex, which didn't seem to be affected. And that's where the input from your eyes goes to that part of the brain first. What people realized when they put this information together is that the presence of the tangles correlated with the symptoms of the disease. So people with Alzheimer's disease often have trouble with new memory formation. They have trouble with orientation in space. They have trouble naming objects very often. But they don't have trouble moving around, certainly not early in the disease. They don't go blind. They can see perfectly fine. And so what was concluded was that the symptoms of the disease are often associated with where the neurofibrillary tangles form. And this is something that we see over and over in a study of brain diseases, and that is it doesn't matter so much what damages the brain, but it matters what part of the brain is damaged, and that's what's going to cause the symptoms. So, for example, if there was a stroke that affected the hippocampus, you would have a memory problem because it's the hippocampus that's being affected. If there was a stroke that was affecting your speech center, then you would have a problem with speech. If those things are affected by neurofibrillary tangles, you have the same sorts of symptoms. The other thing that was noted was that the plaques, which are not specific to areas, seem to be occurring a little bit earlier. So there were these investigators identified a number of brains where there were a lot of plaques, but not really any tangles. And the thought in that case was these were brains of individuals who had not yet gotten Alzheimer's disease, did not have memory problems, but if they had lived a little bit longer, the presence of those plaques would have led to the accumulation of tangles, and then the tangles would have caused the symptoms of the disease. And we'll come back to that model of Alzheimer's disease progression in just a little bit. So as the plaques accumulate and then they lead to the accumulation of tangles, what you see is an atrophy of specific brain regions. So this is a cross-section of a human brain here. This is a side view of a human brain. And this is what a normal brain looks like. We have all these gyruses and sulci forming what we've come to understand as the way a normal brain looks. If you look at it in cross-section, you can see these sulci as the tissue comes in and goes back out into a gyrus here. There are parts of the brain involved, you know, we've talked about this already, in language, or this is the hippocampus where the new memories are formed. But if you look at an Alzheimer's disease brain, the tissue is the neurons, the gray matter where the neurons are, gets much smaller. Some brain regions are a lot smaller, and in particular, the hippocampus can atrophy a great deal. And so if we look at the whole brain of an Alzheimer's patient, it can be up to a third smaller than a normal brain. And that's because we're losing a lot of synapses, we're losing a lot of neurons, and particularly we're losing them in areas that are responsible for some higher cognitive functions like memory or language or judgment. We can look at that progression in a living person by studying what parts of the brain are using glucose at any given time. And this is something that's called FDG PET. But basically what it is we give radioactive glucose to someone, and then we see what parts of the brain are particularly using that glucose. This is an image of what parts of the brain are using less glucose than they normally use. And so the whole brain of an Alzheimer patient is not using, it's not that there's less glucose use everywhere. There are just some regions of the brain that are using less than they normally do. And those are areas in particularly involved in memory formation, as an example. There's a condition that we called mild cognitive impairment. And what that is we think of it as a stage before Alzheimer's disease. And that is, there is a little bit of cognitive impairment, the person is not having problems with, for example, their activities of daily living. They are getting through their days okay. But even at this stage, you can see some regions of the brain where we're not using as much glucose as we normally do. And so that is becoming part of a diagnosis of a new condition, like I said, of mild cognitive impairment. And so if we look over time, the way we envision this is that, so this will be time on the x-axis, and we look at cognitive function on the y-axis. And people who are diagnosed with MCI, their mini mental state exam, they're doing quite well. You'll remember that 30 was the highest. So maybe they're missing a couple of questions, and there might be sort of a subjective idea that their memory's not quite as good as it used to be. But what happens quite often to these individuals is that they will progress over a period of several years into what could then be described as mild Alzheimer's disease. So now their mini mental state exam number comes down a little farther. They get into some of those symptoms that I was talking about before in terms of asking questions over and over. And then now we're starting to get into an impairment of daily functions. And then since it's a neurodegenerative disease, things will degenerate. So invariably the condition gets worse. And like I said, that's a period that can take a number of years. We are trying to move our understanding of the disease earlier and earlier to understanding what's going wrong in MCI and what's going wrong even before MCI, because we think that this is our hope for trying to treat and prevent the disease. We are worried that as we start to treat people later and later in the disease, that there will be just a limited number of things that we can actually do at that point. Once there's been a lot of brain damage, it would become very difficult to reverse any of that. One of the things that we've been able to do as an Alzheimer research community is develop ways of looking at those plaques and tangles in a living person. So you'll remember that I showed you a picture from someone who died of the disease, but what we'd really like is to be able to look at those things while the person is still alive. And so a group at Pittsburgh developed a compound that they made radioactive, and it will bind to the plaques and the tangles in an Alzheimer's disease brain. And then we can use a PET scan to look at where that compound binds. And what you see is in somebody with Alzheimer's disease, you can see that compound binding to a lot of different brain regions. But in a control individual, we see an absence of amyloid. And you can quantify that score. And so this is just a measure of that amyloid that we were measuring in vivo. And you can see that in an Alzheimer patient, we have a lot of that amyloid, and in all these control patients, we had very little amyloid. And then in between, we have these cases that we're not quite sure what to do with, these people with mild cognitive impairment. And some of them have a lot of amyloid, and some of them don't have a lot of amyloid. And what we are hypothesizing and testing over the next coming years as a community is that these people with a lot of amyloid are going to be the ones who progress to Alzheimer's disease. And these people who don't have a lot of amyloid won't necessarily progress. Maybe they will accumulate amyloid and then progress. We just don't know. But this is the research that has just been being developed over the last few years. So we are left with a situation where we can identify a number of things presynaptic, presymptomatically. So, for example, this green line is a measure of that amyloid imaging agent that I was talking to you about. And so our thought is, even before the disease occurs, that amyloid is accumulating in the brains of some people. And then after it's been around for a while, we start to, those people move into conditions of mild cognitive impairment. So early mild cognitive impairment. And this will be a time when, for example, their cognitive performance starts to get a little bit worse. And so what we're trying to do is identify more things in this presymptomatic area so that we can know who are people who are at risk for going on to Alzheimer's disease. And then as these things get worse, as their cognitive performance gets worse, then their function will get worse over time as well. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about what we think causes Alzheimer's disease. And, you know, the short answer is we really don't know. We certainly know risk factors for Alzheimer's disease, and the biggest risk factor is, of course, aging. There's something about the aging process that changes whether you will get Alzheimer's disease or not. But there are a number of other factors that seem to influence it, whether you get Alzheimer's, and family history is certainly one of them, and we'll talk about genetics in a slide or two. Females have a higher risk of Alzheimer's disease, and that's not simply related to the fact that they, on average, live longer. Having a head trauma increases your risk of Alzheimer's disease, and that can be a head trauma at any point in your life, but one that was serious enough to cause some neurologic problem, like losing consciousness or having repeated headaches. People with Down syndrome, all of them will develop Alzheimer's disease. So usually we see signs as early as in the 30s and 40s of Down syndrome, but certainly by the time somebody with Down syndrome is in their 50s, we will see signs of Alzheimer's disease. Protective factors, being male is a protective factor, higher education. The more education you have, the less risk of being diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. Physical exercise seems to be consistently found to protect against Alzheimer's disease. And then there's some interesting studies about anti-inflammatory drugs. So like ibuprofen, reducing the risk of Alzheimer's disease. But we're not quite sure if that it would be true. We're not sure if that's true. It's based on epidemiology studies. We have learned an awful lot from genetics and about how Alzheimer's disease progresses, and some of the genetics comes from families that where there is a lot of Alzheimer's disease. So these would be families with early onset, people who get the disease in their 60s or 50s or 40s even. Half the people in the family get the disease. It goes from generation to generation. And there have been mutations that have been identified in several genes that cause the disease. So if you inherit this mutation, you will get the disease. And three genes have been identified that have mutations that cause Alzheimer's disease, and they're listed here, APP, presenilin-1, and presenilin-2. This has led to a understanding that we've developed about how we think the disease starts, certainly in these individuals. So this is a cartoon that somebody put together of a cell, and then these are proteins that are stuck in the surface of the cell, and this is the inside of the cell. And one of these proteins is APP. So this is the protein that is encoded by the APP gene. And what we have found is that the APP gene, normally it sticks in the membrane like this, but sometimes enzymes come along and cut it into small pieces, and it can generate a little protein that we call beta amyloid, And then the beta amyloid will accumulate into small groups and then into larger fibrils and then into a plaque. So this is what a plaque is made up of, is this little peptide A-beta. And A-beta comes from this larger protein called APP. Presenilin is one of those other genes that I mentioned. It encodes another protein, and this protein is responsible for one of these cuts of APP that leads to the generation of A-beta and then the accumulation of plaques. And so these are things that we've learned from studying these rare families that have early onset familial Alzheimer's disease. So this has helped us as a community identify targets for treatments that we would want to develop that would reduce your risk of Alzheimer's disease. Together, we have put these this information into a pathway that we called the amyloid cascade hypothesis, and that is we start with this protein APP. It gets cleaved by a couple of enzymes that we've called beta secretase and gamma secretase to make this peptide beta amyloid or A-beta. And then as the A-beta sits around in the brain, it causes various kinds of stress, oxidative stress, inflammation. It can kill neurons. And then as we get neuron death, we get the accumulation of tangles and neuron death. And so the things that I've talked about, Down syndrome or APP mutations or presenilin mutations, affect these early stages in the disease process, and then that leads to the entire Alzheimer's disease development. This is one sort of way of looking at genetics, but there's another way of looking at genetics, and that is looking at cases of sporadic Alzheimer's disease. And this is most of the Alzheimer's disease that's out there. This is the late onset Alzheimer's disease. And what we're looking at are genes that change your risk of Alzheimer's disease, not genes that cause the disease, but genes that change your risk of the disease. And one of the examples of genes like this is a gene called APOE. And this is a gene that I study in a number of labs here at Georgetown study. There's a lot of information here, but I'll just go through it briefly. There's three different forms of the APOE gene that you might have inherited. You might have inherited APOE2 or APOE3 or APOE4. And since you inherited one copy from your mother and one copy from your father, you've actually inherited two of these. You could have inherited two APOE2s or two APOE3s or an APOE3 and an APOE4. But this is what's called your APOE genotype. If we look at a control population, most people have inherited two copies of APOE3, but a number of people have inherited one or two copies of APOE4. About a quarter of the population in the United States has inherited one or two copies of APOE4. When we look at an Alzheimer's disease population, what we see is a lot more APOE4 than we would have expected. So that a lot of people with Alzheimer's disease have inherited, for example, two copies of APOE4. Even though those people are pretty rare in the control population, what happens is if you're born with this genotype, you will probably progress to Alzheimer's disease. And the way we talk about that is that if you've inherited one copy of APOE4, your risk for Alzheimer's disease is up by three times. And if you've inherited two copies of APOE4, your risk is up by 10 times. One of the things that that I've been quite interested in lately, I've been studying some young individuals with a lab from the psychology department here at Georgetown. We've been looking at people in their 20s who have Alzheimer's disease, and we've been using some of these brain imaging techniques to see if we can find any changes early in the disease process. And it's been really quite striking that I won't go through exactly all the things that are going on in this slide, but I think you can see that in the individuals who don't have APOE4, There's a lot of oxygen use when these people are in the scanner doing a task that we've given them to do, but that the individuals who were born with an APOE4 allele have much less oxygen use during this task. So this is making us think that the changes in the brain associated with APOE happen much earlier than occurs in Alzheimer's disease. The average age in this study was 22. So there are changes to the brain that occur very early and maybe predispose somebody to increased risk of Alzheimer's disease. I'm just going to finish up with a brief overview of how we currently treat Alzheimer's disease. And really what we do is we try to treat the symptoms of the disease. Right now, our treatments have mainly focused on one of the neurotransmitters that your brain uses to communicate, and that is this neurotransmitter called acetylcholine. And you lose the neurons that have acetylcholine as Alzheimer's disease progresses. The way that looks is you can have a neuron that secretes acetylcholine, and this this neurotransmitter goes across the synapse, and it will bind to receptors on the next neuron in order to communicate with this neuron. As the neurotransmitter is released, it gets broken down by these enzymes called acetylcholinesterase, and that's so that when you release it, the acetylcholine can have an effect briefly, but then it can be degraded and the effect can be turned off. So you can move on to the next thought, to the next motion. But in Alzheimer's disease, we're losing a lot of the acetylcholine. And so what we do is we add an inhibitor that prevents the breakdown of the acetylcholine. So there's less acetylcholine that's being made, but once we add this acetylcholinesterase inhibitor, then the acetylcholine that is made remains present for longer. And this allows the neurons to communicate better than they had previously. One of the things I wanted to mention was when these drugs were first identified, not that long ago, we went through clinical trials to find out whether these were really useful. And this is data from one of these clinical trials that occurred over a decade ago. And what this looks like is on the x-axis we have time after somebody has begun their trial, and then we have a measure of their cognition, the individual's cognition. And if it goes up, then the cognition is improving. If it goes down, cognition is getting worse. And if we look at somebody historically untreated, what you have is that over time, somebody's cognition will get worse, and that cognition will get worse in a measurable way over maybe 6 months or over a year. So it doesn't get worse right away, but it slowly gets worse. When you look at the people who were treated with one of these acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, actually there's kind of immediately a small improvement in their cognition, but then the cognition does indeed get a little bit worse over time. But really the long-term effect is that there's about a year in time when cognition is held at the level of when the study is started. So somebody who has some signs of Alzheimer's disease will not get clinically worse for about a year, and that can be a really important period of time where people can perhaps stay at home for a year longer than they might otherwise. And so there's a lot of quality of life issues that can be improved in these sorts of cholinesterase, with these cholinesterase inhibitors. So there's a number of treatments that we use, most of them being cholinesterase inhibitors. you know, we have to be careful that the benefit of these medications outweigh any risks associated with them, but they do seem to, in general, improve behaviors, but they do not change the disease. We are not keeping the neurons alive any longer. We're not preventing the amyloid from accumulating. The disease seems to be going forward. We're just trying to allay the symptoms that also occur in Alzheimer's disease. So in what we're trying to do as a research community is identify things that might prevent the disease or might actually stop the disease from progressing. And so we've been generating drugs that prevent the APP from being degraded or get rid of the A-beta once it accumulates in those plaques, or we're trying to protect the neurons from dying after they're exposed to the amyloid, and we're trying to move earlier and earlier in the disease process. One of the ways we do that is we do studies on transgenic animals, and so we have mouse models of Alzheimer's disease, and we can study whether these mice get amyloid deposits in their brain and how we can try to get rid of those amyloid deposits. And we can also study memory in these animals. And I have to say that we can put these animals in relatively tricky mazes and see how well they remember things like, how do I get out of this water maze? Because they're mice and they don't like being in water. We can determine whether they can remember how to get out of these mazes. So I just want to leave with this idea that what we're trying to do is prevent the generation of A-beta as it's being made from APP. Maybe we're trying to prevent its aggregation into a plaque. We're trying to prevent how that plaque leads to neuronal loss. Maybe we're taking approaches to clearing that plaque after it's formed. But all of these are experimental approaches to preventing the dementia that is accumulating as the A-beta accumulates. If you want any more information, there's a couple of sites here at Georgetown that are worth going to. There's a memory disorders program here at Georgetown that runs a lot of clinical trials, and here's their website. So certainly the website will be informative. If you're in the D.C. area, the website is helpful for people who might want to be involved in clinical trials. If you're in the D.C. area, we also run lab tours for people who want to know more information. Here's a phone number. And then my lab has its own website that's a little more research-oriented, so you can use that site as well. So, Emily, I think that's my last slide. So what do I do now?
Thank you so much. We're going to enter into the Q&A component. We've gotten a lot of questions already, and just to remind folks, you can submit your questions through the question area of your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Bill, we've gotten a lot of questions related to people's risk being increased if they have a close relative with Alzheimer's disease. Would you mind touching on that point, please?
So, absolutely, and we've learned a lot about the genetics of Alzheimer's disease, so we can be a little more specific. If we go back a number of years, if you had a close relative, and by close relative it could be, you know, a mother or a father, it could be a brother or a sister, if you have somebody that close to you of Alzheimer's disease, your risk, I think it was about doubled. Now we it also matters when those people got Alzheimer's disease. So if somebody got Alzheimer's disease when they were 85 years old, unfortunately, the disease is such that a lot of people get Alzheimer's disease at that age. So that's not as much of, that doesn't have as big an effect on whether you'll get Alzheimer's disease or not. If they got Alzheimer's disease in their early 60s, then that's more of a there seems to be more of a genetic component to that. People do figure out which genes, which versions of different genes you've got that might affect your risk. The difficulty is that even if you knew that, there's nothing to do. We don't have any treatments that could actually help you. So for example, we don't actually determine which versions of APOE that you've inherited to let you know that, because there's just not value to knowing that. And we don't have anything in place to help you through that information. If you find out that you are at really high risk, we don't have the resources to say, okay, let's talk about exactly what that means. We generally do not like find out exactly which APOE genes people have inherited. Was that helpful?
Yes, definitely. Interesting question. Is there any evidence that antioxidants help delay the onset of Alzheimer's? What about cholesterol-lowering drugs?
There's, for both of those things, there's a little bit of interesting epidemiology. And by epidemiology, I mean studies are done on large populations, and you get people who have lived to an old age, and you break them into groups and say, here's a group of people who are 80 years old and they're fine, and here's a group of people who are 80 years old and had Alzheimer's disease. Can we look back on their lives and learn things about what they did in their lives that maybe influenced whether they ended up in the control group or in the Alzheimer group? And some of the things that you can look back on is say, you know, the people who ended up in the control group, when we look back, a lot of them took things like Lipitor to lower their cholesterol. So that has raised this idea that maybe, you know, lowering your cholesterol in earlier in your life affected whether, you know, prevented you from getting the disease late in life. Those, the things that people are focusing more on now are things that actually do happen in midlife. So when we try to do clinical trials of people who already have Alzheimer's disease and feed them drugs like Lipitor, those so far have not been terribly successful. And so the thought has gone back to, well, maybe those drugs were useful when people were younger, people in their 50s or 60s, before they got the disease. So that's what we're trying to do as a community, is to move these clinical trials up earlier and earlier, rather than just depending on trying to treat people who are already well into the disease.
Thank you. Here's an interesting question as well. Bill, is there any research on cultures or countries that have a far lower incident of Alzheimer's disease that may suggest preventative lifestyle choices?
There's several interesting things. It's a little difficult because the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease can vary from one culture to another. I remember years ago somebody talking to me about the diagnosis in Japan, and they were saying that the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease was viewed as a weakness in Japan. They didn't like to diagnose Alzheimer's disease. What they liked to diagnose was stroke, because stroke was viewed as the disease of strength, like you had been working so hard that you had a stroke. So the diagnosis gets a little bit funny across cultures. But with Asian cultures, there are interesting studies of people who have moved from Asian cultures. In particular, there's a big study in Hawaii. So you have a lot of people who've moved from Asian cultures into an American culture and changed their way of life, and particularly we think of as a diet. And what it seems to show is that as people move from an Asian culture with the same genetic background that they had in Asia, As they move into an American diet, they end up, their risk of Alzheimer's disease increases dramatically. So that does argue that there are lifestyle choices that we are making that increase our risk, and probably around this idea of diet. One of the things that I did not mention in my talk is that whenever people do studies of Alzheimer's disease and they look for risk factors, basically they've come to the conclusion that anything that raises your risk of heart disease raises your risk of Alzheimer's disease. So if you have diabetes, your risk of Alzheimer's disease increases. If you have high blood pressure or high cholesterol, your risk of Alzheimer's disease goes up. And so this is, you know, part of the reason that I think the studies that showed that physical exercise reduces your risk of Alzheimer's disease, we clearly need to be taking care of our hearts, and by doing that, we end up taking care of our brains as well.
Thank you. We have a specific question for someone in the group, but I think that others will benefit from hearing it as it deals with a larger issue. Someone on the line, her father has early signs of dementia, and her mother wants to sell the house and move the two of them into an apartment. Do you have any issues that they, can you predict any issues that they should be ready with the significant change in their routine?
The difficulty is, as you go through working with Alzheimer's patients, is whatever you do right now, things will get worse. And so it's a little heartbreaking to watch families deal with problems that are in front of them. Okay, we have a slight memory problem. We're going to make more lists now than we need to, you know, than we previously needed to. We're going to, you know, take some duties away from this person so that they don't have to wander outside the house and run the risk of being lost. You just have to always keep in mind that whatever you're doing right now to get through, the rules will change in 6 months or a year, and there will be some facilities that they presently have that they won't be able to do farther down the line. So then some are very predictable. Would you be living somewhere where you need a car to get around? Because that is going to be difficult for somebody. I think you're going to want to at some point take the keys away from somebody with Alzheimer's disease. You're going to need help, you know, so keep that in mind. Don't move somewhere where you don't have family support or friend support. That's, you know, you're going to need to rely on those people.
Thank you. I've gotten a lot of questions. I'm trying now to determine which ones are good for the whole group to hear. We have gotten a couple questions related to the difference between dementia and Alzheimer's. Someone on the line has a 95-year-old mother, and the doctor had determined that she has dementia but not Alzheimer's. How can they make such a judgment without doing a full autopsy of the brain? Do you have any thoughts on this?
You know, a lot of the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease depends on how it progresses. And so sometimes you will find somebody with dementia, so they have a memory problem, they have some other problem in normal brain function. And then if it's Alzheimer's disease, you know that over time that will get worse. And sometimes you have people where it does not get worse. And so then you think, okay, I'm not quite sure what caused this memory problem in the first place, but it was not Alzheimer's disease. You know, there are other tests that I didn't really talk about in terms of being more sure about the diagnosis. So I showed you that experimental amyloid imaging, which the FDA is just about to approve that for better diagnosis in living individuals for the presence of that amyloid. There are measures that you can take from cerebrospinal fluid. The thing that you have to keep in mind is, why would I want to know this? There are a few causes of dementia that are treatable, and usually a doctor can know that quite easily. So you can measure levels of the vitamin B12 in the system, and if that is very low, that can cause dementia. There are some thyroid problems that cause dementia. Doctors in general will rule those out, and then there'll be that list of other dementias that I showed you, and unfortunately, there's just not anything to do about them. So knowing exactly what the cause of the dementia was is often not useful to the patient.
Thank you. That's helpful. Well, unfortunately, this leaves us at the end of today's webinar. I want to thank you, Bill. This has been very valuable, lots of really helpful information. We've gotten lots of great comments and questions from folks that have really appreciated your time and expertise. And I also want to remind everyone, we'll be sending a follow-up email shortly after we hang up today with details on how to access the archived recording, a copy of the PowerPoint slides, and a follow-up survey, as we'd love to get your thoughts. Bill, I'll turn it over to you if you want to close out with a last-minute comment or thought.
Well, I just want to say that there are a lot of resources out there for you guys to find out more information about Alzheimer's disease. There are the ones at Georgetown that I've shown here on a slide. The Alzheimer's Association has an easy-to-access website. The federal government supports a lot of Alzheimer's research through the NIH. And so there are Alzheimer's centers in various cities across the country. There are resources out there. And certainly, if you contact us here at Georgetown, we can help you direct you to these other resources. And I think the more information you have, the better off you're going to be. It's, from a personal standpoint, from a societal standpoint, it's such an enormous problem. It frightens me that we're not spending nearly the attention on it that we should be. But I'm awfully glad that everybody here found the time to come today. So thank you for that, and good luck. Bye.
Thank you. And we'll be posting an archive recording of this on our website, and we definitely encourage all of you on the line to share the archive webinar with your family and friends. This is a definitely informative and valuable resource. Thank you so much again for everyone for joining us, and we hope you'll join us for other webinars in the future. Have a great day.